It rose in two places. From one it brought rotting vegetation, and from the other potash. And any gardener will tell you what that means. When it flooded every year, it dumped compost and fertilizer onto the land. And the land bloomed. Too well. With easy food, the population grew to where not even the Nile could support it without help. Faced with starvation, the river dwellers tried planting grain by hand. Not enough. What solved their problem was an invention that triggered off a series of events which ends with us in our modern technology trap. Because that invention was to trigger the beginnings of civilization. This is the first great man-made trigger of change, the plough. Because with it you know how much harvest you're going to get next year. And because of that, you know you're going to be here next year. And because of that, you can plan for the future. And after a while, when you can produce surplus food, then that's when things really start to move in the tiny settlements. With regular food supplies, the population explodes. The village expands. There are more buildings and they're bigger for bigger families, and they're more permanent. You domesticate animals for their milk and their meat and their skin because they're not there to hunt anymore. And basket weaving and the twisting of grass to do it teaches you how to spin flax, and that makes linen. But it's the grain that causes the fundamental change, because with it, you bake the bread that is the staple diet on which everybody lives. And you learn about ovens and about the effects of heat on mud and brick. But above all, you have to have somewhere to store the grain surplus, in pots. But there's so much surplus by now, you need the pots to be made faster and you need them to last longer. So the potter's wheel happens. Then comes the problem of who does it belong to? And the only answer to that is this. Writing. And the very first writing takes that form. A name and a symbol for what's inside this pot, or a lot of pots, or an entire village granary. And so the little villages grew with their huts and their granaries. And then, almost out of nowhere it seems, that happened. The oldest stone building in the world. The step pyramid of King Zoser at Saqqara near Cairo. Built around 2700 BC, instant sophisticated architecture from mud huts in one jump. How do they do it? Because of what they'd had to do to feed themselves, irrigate. Because the river flooded every year and destroyed landmarks and then retreated, leaving the soil to dry out, they had to do two things. Find a way of measuring the land so the farmer got his own fields back, and a way of channeling the water away for use after the flood had gone. The kind of measurement you need to do those things involves geometry and the type of mathematics a civil engineer uses. And building canals teaches you to work stone. If you know stonework and geometry and mathematics, you can build pyramids. Especially if a strong central government that was developed to run the irrigation schemes in the first place tells you to. If the pharaoh said he wanted a pointed stone monument, that's what he got. Funny thing is, the same drought that drove everybody down to the Nile also preserved the things they built, like their tombs, for thousands of years. The stuff on the walls in this tomb, for example, is 4,500 years old. A kind of cartoon view of the civilization the plough created. I mean, look, here's irrigation. There are these people carrying water pots, you see them? And they carry them across and they pour the water into a garden that has a wall around it. And then over here, look, there's a fellow doing a bit of weeding. There's the plough. They domesticated oxen. They tried to domesticate any animal that they could get their hands on. I mean, take a look at this. Animal flatten its back, tie its back legs, hang on to its front legs, stuff food down its throat and hope it'll learn to love you. You didn't get too far with that one. It was a hyena. Well, you've got a growing community and plenty of spare food and you'll need to protect yourself. So making weapons becomes very important. And here on this wall, there's a whole thing about handling metals. Look. Here are the weights and measures people checking on how much metal is going to be used. Next to them, the furnace men. You see the way they're raising the temperature? They're blowing on these tubes to create a draft in the furnace to get the temperature high. Next to them, here's the molten metal being poured into a mould. And here, the fella's beating it flat. Okay, you get yourself a kingdom, you get what you deserve. You get bureaucrats. Here they are, the scribes, writing everything down. See the pens behind their ears? In this case, they're noting taxes. Here are the people coming in to pay their taxes, led persuasively by the local police. Here's a policeman with the rod of office. More policemen. Here's an Egyptian scruff of the neck. He obviously doesn't want to pay. If you end up not paying, they get out their whips and they tie you to a pole, and that's what you get for not coming up with the money. So you have a busy, sophisticated society. You have to have people at the top in charge. This is the tomb of one of them. He was a kind of Egyptian chancellor responsible directly to the king. There he is. His name was Mereruka. By sometime around 3200 BC, the entire 700-mile length of the Nile from the Mediterranean to Aswan was united and administered by officials like Mereruka, each one running what was called a water province, the section of the irrigation network and of the river under his command. What held it all together was the king's magic ability as a god to come up year after year with an inundation of the Nile and to know exactly how high the waters would go. Of course, it wasn't magic, it was his astronomers. They observed that one particular star, Sirius, rises just before dawn on one particular day, the 17th of July, every year. And that day is one day before the flood begins. They also saw that on average, the flood itself came once every 365 days. Now you put those two facts together, the star before dawn and the flood, and you've got yourself a calendar. And with a calendar, you can organize people. You can give them a date to do something on. And as for the king's ability to predict how high the water would go, well, you record the level of the flood every year with a scratch on the wall. And after a while, your experience will tell you early on how high the water's going to be later. Now, in Egypt, where water is life, that kind of knowledge and ability to control gives you the power to build empires.